In the last month, there have been significant battlefield changes, especially in the sectors of Avdiivka, where just recently Russian forces have thrust deep into the center of the city, threatening to encircle Ukrainian troops in the southern half of town. Also on the northern frontier, Ukrainian troops were forced to retreat as the Russians achieved a 6-kilometer breakthrough of their defenses on the outskirts of Kupiansk. Hello everyone and welcome back to New World Geopolitics. The beginning of 2024 has been a bit hectic for me, taking care of some personal business, so it's been around a month since the last update on the channel, but I'm going to go jump back into reporting on the war. So hopefully I can achieve some kind of regular posting schedule throughout 2024. Even though I haven't been posting, I have been following along with daily events, and I have noticed some interesting patterns in the fighting. So we're going to talk about that today. I am prepared and ready and read up and ready to get back to providing quality updates on what's going on in Ukraine. So with that being said, we have quite a bit to talk about. So like always, consider liking and subscribing to help me hit the ground running, and consider following on Twitter or Telegram. The links to those you can find in the description. So I'm going to gloss through a very quick overview, and I'm sure I will miss a lot here, but I'm trying to keep this around 10 minutes. I know that's typically hard for me to achieve. So I want to spend the bulk of that time talking about Avdiivka. First, starting in the north, there was a significant breakthrough by Russian forces directly west of Kupiansk. This started, this actually happened several weeks ago, so I'm sure most of you already are aware. The push was around 6 kilometers deep into Ukrainian lines, with the Russians capturing the town of Tobayevka and the small settlement of Krokmalny. The latter not being much more than a handful, maybe 3 farmhouses, really. Now, this did result in around 35 square kilometers coming under Russian control. Certainly the largest gain from an assault this year, and probably the largest, or one of the largest for sure, since the Ukrainian summer offensive ended in 2023. And the Russians retook the initiative. I will point out that in the area north of Kupiansk and the Sinkivka forests, I have marked a gray zone in this area. Basically, what I'm saying here, since this is so back and forth, of course the gray zone exists along the entire front line, but at any given point in this specific area, the front line could really be anywhere, and I'm tired of changing it, honestly. So, we're just going to leave it like this until some kind of major update happens there. So in the Liman area, Russians continue to push in the direction of Terni and Yampolivka, working their way through the forest belts. The Ukrainians have also been active, taking some ground back through counterattacks, and some is probably attributed to map adjustments. Moving quickly on to Siversk, the environment there, there has been a recent flare-up north of the river in the location that we've coined as the Krimina Forest to the south, as Russians captured the small farming settlement of Vesel, along with a number of trench networks that leveled out the front line. Now, moving on to the Bakhmut area, it seems there seems to be a great deal of activity and talk, but not much movement on the front line, at least to the north. Ukraine forced the Russians back and lives to fight another day for Bogdanovka, and the Russians were also forced out of overextended positions in the forest belt overlooking Ivanovsky to the north. This was a hilltop forested position, strong position, but probably a bit out of reach for where the Russians are currently. Probably fairly easy for the Ukrainians to take back, although there has been recent fighting here just over the last 24 hours, and it's really unsettled on who controls the cemetery at this point. Last I knew it was in the gray zone, but some updates are suggesting it might be under Russian control now. Now I mentioned at the beginning, we need to talk about the south of Bakhmut. There has been more significant changes down here, with a number of important trench networks between Bakhmut and Klishivka falling back into Russian hands. Klishivka, surprisingly, actually still appears to be mostly under Ukrainian control, or within the gray zone. So they've actually managed to hold out there pretty well over the last month. Now, I did mention at the beginning that I noticed a pattern with the fighting in Ukraine. And it's not something I'm certain about, but the logic seems sound, so I'll run it by you guys. But take it with a grain of salt. Certainly, or clearly, Ukraine has reserves, and if they didn't, then every time a Ukrainian soldier dies on the front line, it would get thinner and eventually have big holes. Not something we've seen wide scale. On top of that, if the Russians concentrate forces and the Ukrainians are spread evenly across the front, the Russians could just overwhelm them at any particular point, right? So in order to meet the Russians where the Russians decide to attack, Ukraine must have a mobile mechanized force and mobile artillery that can rapidly move between sections of the front and halt Russian attacks. Something akin to what I think the U.S. military calls a QRF, which would be like a quick reaction force. I can elaborate more on this in a later video where I can use up more than 10 minutes, but bear with me and pretend this is the current reality. Russia attacks Avdiivka, Ukrainian reinforcements arrive and slowly progress there. Russia moves north to Bakhmut, and then, you know, Ukrainian reinforcements arrive in slow process. Then Russia moves down to Marinka and captures Marinka. A little too far, a little bit in the opposite direction. Ukrainians can't get reinforcements there fast enough. Then the Russians attack again at Bakhmut, and then at Avdiivka, and then all the way to the north in Kupiansk, and then they go back to Avdiivka, then Bakhmut, then Novomihailovka. What essentially it seems like what I'm saying is Russia is timing their attacks. You know, sure, weather has something to do with it, but out of the five or six places where Russia is placing enormous pressure, they're only ever pressing the attack on one or two locations at any given day, and it seems to be random where the attacks are going to be that day. So Ukraine has the strength to repel the Russians in one or two locations, but the constant switching of the focus causes Ukraine to constantly move their mobile reserves to different sections of the front. And sometimes they're not going to show up there on time, and sometimes they're not going to accurately predict where the Russians are attacking. So all the while, Russia is heavily bombarding each location and withering down the Ukrainian troops that are permanently stationed there. So, you know, the Russian assault troops are getting rested during that time because they don't, you know, they have enough troops to where they don't have to move their own forces around. Perhaps maybe they have to, you know, concentrate artillery on different fronts at different times. But, you know, for the most part, it seems like the Russians aren't struggling with manpower. You know, the drone crews are working on thinning out Ukrainian forces, and the Ukrainians are forced to evenly distribute their fresh conscripts to different sectors that are all incurring heavy losses. So it seems to me like a disastrous situation is forming, and that disaster is culminating at Avdiivka. The recent gains here by the Russians are borderline disastrous for the Ukrainians. Reports suggest that that strategy is going to be adjusted and large numbers of reinforcements for the Ukrainians are on the way, but at this point it is hard to see if Ukraine can reverse the situation or even achieve a similar result to Bakhmut, where they delayed the battle to the beginning of summer, or, you know, sometime in early May. Looking at the overview here, you can see the very significant Russian gains. When we last spoke of the Avdiivka pocket, it was around 64 square kilometers, and that's basically measuring a line here, you know, south of Stepova and the factory to Severny. So everything to the east of this line here, 64 square kilometers in the pocket. Russia, since in the last month, has captured a little over 10 square kilometers, probably a little more than that in the last day or two, reducing the entire size of the pocket by 17% in a month, and it's some of the most critical 17%. So breaking it down into the northern direction, Russian forces finished capturing the Dachas and the northern side of the reservoir and rapidly pushed deep into the heart of the city, with some estimates saying that they now hold over 20% of the city limits. Even worse, they managed to cross the railroad tracks down here in this location. And wow, that's not the right size or the right color. Let's see here. Down here in this location, they've already crossed the railroad tracks. Some people are suggesting that the Russians are attacking a car plant, which is right here, and then a chemical LLC that's in this area here, but I don't have any word on any successes there as of this moment. South of the town, the situation isn't much better. Ukraine has lost a key foothold in a southern neighborhood, along with most of the southern forest belt. The long-standing air defense base, which actually I can probably mark it for you guys right here, down here, this base right here. Initially was overrun. A counterattack reestablished some control over the northern parts of it, but looking at the battlefield assets, some of the strongest fortified and defensible positions in the region were in this area and have been lost over the last month, or they are on the verge of being surrounded. So, traditionally in these situations, people have speculated that the Russians will continue placing pressure on the flanks, on the pincers. So let's actually get rid of these battlefield assets. They kind of annoy me. So in this area, a lot of people are saying the Russians are going to try to, continue the pressure here and close it off and encircle all these Ukrainian troops. But so far we haven't, that hasn't really been the case. It seems like Sun Tzu, the art of war, always give your enemy, a path to escape, because when their back's to the wall, they fight to the death. So it seems like the Russians have been following that. They seem to always, allow the Ukrainians a route to escape. Not only that, but these two areas right here, and let's just get some of these lines off, are the most likely locations for Ukrainian counterattack. I do think the Russians will continue pressure in these locations, but I don't think they're going to focus their attack here. I think that they're going to try to take ground if they can, but mainly try to hold it, try to hold back the Ukrainian counterattack, which inevitably will come here. There's really nowhere else for them to counterattack. I mean, they could counterattack in other places, here, try to relieve some pressure, but it needs to happen here as well. So the Russians know it's coming there. In the meantime, there will be some very vulnerable areas of the Ukrainian defense. And let's go ahead and change up the colors here. So I expect Ukrainian counterattacks here in the future. And meanwhile, these areas on the fringes will be ripe for the picking. The air defense base almost already encircled. The Donetsk filtration plant and the forests here. There's if you zoom in and look at some other mapping, this area is under quite a lot of stress here. And then this area, small residential zone with actually a highly fortified trench network. The Russians haven't managed to penetrate it yet, is on the verge of encirclement now from the direction of the reservoir. So, some of these smaller encirclements make a lot more sense for the Russians. Destroy or capture smaller units, company battalion size. Battalion would be big, but company size units, far more achievable and worthwhile. And they can work on these things and work on forcing the Ukrainians out of these positions, all while Ukraine is dealing with these areas, and all while Ukraine is struggling to get supplies through here. So it seems to me like the writing's on the wall, at least for southern Avdiivka. It's probably going to fall pretty rapidly. Something I haven't mentioned yet is that Zelensky has just fired the head of the armed forces, General Zaluzhny. There is a lot going around Telegram channels citing the reasons as failures here in Avdiivka, and perhaps a bit about personal rivalry and insubordination. I don't know about any of all that. Of course, I've read the rumors, but I can't speak to them. I will say that a general like Zaluzhny has been and still probably is what Ukraine needs, especially compared to someone like this Budanov character, someone who has no experience as a general, and probably is going to focus on special forces activity, which just this just isn't that kind of war. That like this isn't American Afghanistan. They're on the smaller side fighting a Goliath. They have to meet the Russians with some force. So small unit operations just probably would be worse. So the Ukrainians have replaced Zaluzhny with Sirsky, Alexander Sirsky. You know, a lot of bad things about him as well, but you know, it's at least he's probably gonna follow along Zaluzhny's same strategy, which you know, more and more I'm coming to think is the soundest way moving forward that Ukraine has, you know, is try to meet the Russians. You know, although Ukrainian strategy I think results in quite a bit of casualties, I'm not so sure that any other strategy would result in less casualties. And at the bare minimum, you could say, I think there's something honorable about, you know, fighting for you know, not giving anything up without a fight. You know, that's it's you know, throughout history, I think it's pretty respectable. Although, you know, could also be characterized as callous. So, you know, change of strategy from here, that's completely another other debate, but I think you know, change of leadership was probably warranted. You know, Zaluzhny has led the army for 2 years, and the last year of that has seen a string of defeats. So, you know, probably the public, the political structure, the partners abroad, I would guess all probably wanted some kind of change here. So, you know, this might not be the change they needed, but it's change. Moving on to the final updates west of Marinka, the Russians have continued to make some progress on the ponds in the direction of Grigorovka. And then south of that, Novomykhailovka, there's been some news here. This is another one of the rotating fronts. Pretty large section of land captured south of town, about 10 square kilometers of farmland falling under Russian control, puts them pretty close to a supply road that heads down to Vuhledar. I think if we go with everything, you can see that road running right through here. So, attacks in Novomykhailovka itself has started back up. Some pictures of Russian flag being raised in one of the houses came out. Since then, Ukrainian channels are claiming of a counterattack and forcing Russian troops back out of town. Although I have not seen photo or video evidence to the same level of the Russian photo video evidence that they had actually entered the town. So we are not sure of that yet. All right, guys, that's it for me today. Be on the lookout for more updates coming. I will have, you know, less to go through, and we'll get a little more into depth on each part of the front in the future. That's all for me today, and until next time.